Thanks, Riddhi, for the introduction. Okay, so in some sense, this week we are seeing probabilistic techniques in negative curvature. This reverse. So we'll use some negative curvature techniques in probability. So it's the other way. So the big picture goes as follows. So I'll define all the, by the way, there are three phrases here. And I'll mostly concentrate on the first phrase. I'll try to tell you what it means. And then towards the end, I'll give you a motivation, not define it, but what is extremal co-cycle growth. And only a bit of Patterson-Sullivan measure in come in my talk, but then Mahan will take over, he will do the rest. So there's something called stable random fields, which comes up in probability. And I'll basically, as I said, my talk would be really to define what it is and how it is connected to the rest of the phrases. So this is coming to probability. And then dynamics, there is something called quasi-invariant group actions. I'll define that too. And it was known in the literature in probability that these two things are connected. And these two things got connected to a famous work of Rosinski. Then through my collaborator Mahan, I came to know that these quasi-invariant group actions, they naturally arise in hyperbolic geometry. So more specifically, hyperbolic dynamics. So this work essentially connects these two subjects. That's the broad overview. So I'll start from the definition of stable random fields. But before defining, I have to define what is called a stable random variable. Here is the first definition. So a random variable y is said to follow, so this is the notation, symmetric alpha stable distribution with scale parameter sigma. So this S alpha S stands for symmetric alpha stable. If the characteristic function of the random variable, which is also the Fourier transform of the random variable, which is expectation of E theta y, this is given by e power minus theta runs over real numbers. Now one should check that this is a valid characteristic function. In other words, there is actually a random variable for which this would become the Fourier transform. As long as alpha is a parameter that's between 0 and 2, 2 included, 0 is not, and sigma is a positive real number. These are the parameters of this distribution. Now there is one value of alpha for which we all have seen this distribution. So if alpha is 2, oh, before I say that, maybe I'll first say the following. Here I'm taking the expectation of a complex random variable. What I'm getting is a real number. So using that, one can show that the distribution of y is symmetric around 0. So in other words, what would follow immediately is that the distribution of y and minus y, they have the same law, the same distribution. So the distribution of y is symmetric around 0. Now one special case that we have all seen it is the alpha equal to 2 case. This would imply that y follows a normal distribution. However, for this talk, we are going to assume that it is non-Gaussian. We are going to assume that alpha is strictly between 0 and 2. So this is the assumption that will be always in this term. So basically, we are going to look at symmetric alpha stable random variable, which is non-Gaussian. So alpha is strictly between 0 and 2. Okay, so where do these random variables arise? So they arise as, so we all know central limit theorem, and when you have a random variable which has finite variance, suppose the random variable is symmetric to start with, so it has 0, the mean has to be 0. So then we all know that if it has finite variance, then after, if you take the sum of iid such n, iid of such copies, random variable, you divide it by square root of n, that converges to normal. You all know this. But suppose you don't have finite variance. You just know that the random variables are symmetric. And with some more extra condition about the random variable, one can show that in that case, the scaling limit, if it exists, has to be one of these random variables. So therefore, these random variables are important because they are obtained as scaling limits of sums of iid random variable. So if alpha was 2, then you will get the case where the variable is finite. If not, you will get the other alphas. That's why they are in. Okay. So now I'm ready to define what is called symmetric alpha stable random field. So for this talk, G, and also for Mahan, would be a countable group. And after some time, I'm going to assume finitely generated. So let's start with that assumption. Although some of the statements I'll write won't need that, but let's start with that assumption. And then we'll fix a generating symmetric S, and we'll also take, I'll use D to be the word metric with respect to this generating set. Okay, so to start with, you can just assume any countable group and not necessarily commutative. That's very important. So here is the definition of what is called a symmetric stable random field. So I'll have a collection of random variables indexed by this group. So this called symmetric alpha stable random field. I'm going to abbreviate random field as R dot F later on because I have to write it too many times. If you take any finite linear combination, by the way, this alpha is the same alpha as there, and it's strictly between 0 and 2. Any finite linear combination of these YGs is going to follow some symmetric alpha stable distribution. And of course, the scale parameter sigma would depend on the CIs. So in other words, if you have a collection of random variables, you take any finite linear combination, that's going to follow symmetric alpha stable. In particular, all the random variables YGs are going to follow symmetric alpha stable as well. That's it. Okay, so, and we know that once you specify all the finite linear combinations, you essentially specify the distribution. So this uniquely specifies the joint distribution of all the YGs. Okay, so I'll have to notate. So for any measure space, so I have a measure space, not necessarily finite, so sub sigma finite measure space. So I'll use the notation. So for any map, so you take any map from omega to R, any measurable map, define. Write it like a norm, but it always won't be a norm. So this is essentially what you do is you look at the integral of h power alpha over gamma, and then take 1 over alpha. I'll denote by this. Of course, a priori, there is no reason why this should be finite. Then I'll call L alpha to be those functions for which this thing would be finite. Now note that one thing I should point out is that as long as alpha is, so my alpha is always between 0 and 2. Okay? Alpha is between 1 and 2, this is actually norm, and this will actually become a Banach space. But it would never become a Hilbert space because it's alpha is strictly less than 2. And alpha less than 1, it would be even more even to rigid space compared to bounded space. It's not even norm space. Okay, so why did I bring this up? So here is a result. This goes back to quotes. It says the following, which says that suppose you start with a symmetric alpha stable random field indexed by a group of sort, finitely generated, and a fixed generating set also. So it's a still symmetric alpha stable random field. Then there exists a measure space and a bunch of L alpha functions indexed by the group such that in the definition I said that any finite linear combination is symmetric alpha stable. I never told you what this sigma parameter is. Now, the sigma parameter can be determined in terms of these functions. So this means that I should write any finite linear combination. By the way, I should have said this. My random variables are all real valued. So therefore, this is also coming from R. So it's a real linear combination. Any real linear combination. This will be symmetric alpha stable, and the sigma parameter will be totally determined by the CIs and these functions FGIs. And the specifically, it will be this. So, in other words, what this says is that if you start with any abstract S alpha S random field, you'll be able to look at all the finite linear combinations of this YGs, and the distribution would be given by in terms of the CIs and these functions FGs and their L alpha norms. So this is represent, so this FGs are representations of this random field YG. Sorry, yeah. Not so far. Yes, that's a very good question. So far, your G can be any set, any countable set, or otherwise you will need more structure. But so far, we haven't used the group property. We'll use it soon. Okay. Interestingly, the converse is also true. So converse also holds. Now, what do I mean by that? I won't write it. I'll just say it of this result. In the sense, if you start with any measure space, gamma, the sigma finite measure, so a priori this is not necessarily a finite measure space, as I said, and you start with any collection of functions which are in L alpha, indexed by this G, you can always find a symmetric alpha stable random field which will satisfy this property. So let me a square on this, and I'll call this 1, and keep it for some time. Okay, so then, now since I already pointed out about group structure, I'll use it. So now I'll give a definition where the group structure will be used. Okay, so here is the most crucial definition. So, called left stationary. So I won't use, from now on, I'll just call it stationary. But I will always mean left stationary. If for every H in G, if you look at the, if you shift this index parameter, so you have, this is an index parameter, right? So YG is, basically you have G many random variables. You shift the index parameter by this H on the left side. This has the same distribution as that is I'll make it a little bit more precise. So if you take for all G1, G2, up to GK, and H in G, and for all Borel subsets of RK, obviously this is Borel. If you look at the joint probability of YG1 up to YGK in B, this probability should be equal to the HG1 up to YHGK. So in other words, what I am saying is that the law of this YG or the distribution of this YG remains invariant when you do left translation in the indices. So this is basically, this action is a measure preserving action. No. Why is this real valued random variable? I have stated that, but I should. Yeah, thank you. Real valued random variable. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Okay. That's why I'm taking this finite linear combinations over the real. Okay, thanks. Okay. So any other questions so far? Okay. So then, of course, the question is then, you have a symmetric alpha stable random field, and here we have a group action. So we are using the group property already. And the question is, of course, this, if you have such a random field, you do have its representation like that. But how does this invariance that you have over there get transferred into this FGs? So that's the result of Rosinski. So what he proved is the following. So even though this action is invariant, when you see it at the FG level, it doesn't remain invariant, but it becomes what is quasi-invariant. So I'll define that first. So here is the definition. Suppose you group G. So for my talk, this is always going to be a measure space, sigma finite a priori. So and your group G is acting on this. Now for all G, find this map phi G from gamma to gamma as it sends X from gamma to G X. G dot X, the shift by T. Suppose each of, I'm saying this action is a measurable action. Each of these maps is measurable. This action is called quasi-invariant. Of course, when is it called, when is it invariant? Let's first write that. It's called invariant if mu compose of A equals mu of A. This is an invariant. Now it's called quasi-invariant we all write inverse. If okay, so invariant means the action preserves the measure. So by the way, this you can recognize this is nothing but G star mu. It's the pushover of this measure by G. Quasi-invariant means it preserves the measure class, not necessarily the measure, which means the pushover has the same null sets as the actual measure. So it's obviously, it's clear that if something is invariant, then it's quasi-invariant, but the other side is not true. There can be an example. Actually, we'll see one such example later. Okay, so is it clear what Poisson invariant means? So it's an action which preserves the measure class. It's an action which, after shifting, the measure is absolutely continuous with respect to the original. Okay. Now, with that background, I can now state the result of Rosinski, which essentially answers the following question. If you have a stationary, it's less stationary in our S alpha is a random field, and how do the representations look? So here is a theorem. Jan Rosinski. So it says that the stationary symmetric alpha stable random field implies there exists a representation which looks like this. Essentially, this is shift of one map through a non-singular group action, except that I have to bring in a random nicotine derivative co-cycle here. X is coming from gamma, and G is coming from the group. So what this says is that, so essentially what this says is that you have a group here, you read off that the same thing at the level of representations, you may not be able to get something invariant, but you'll definitely get something quasi-invariant, something that will preserve the measure class. So let me put a box on that also. Two. Phi, no, this is, in this case, it's just phi g. It so happens that it is phi g. Yeah. So it's basically pushed forward by the inverse, yeah. Okay. So if you look at right stationarity, then you will get the inverse. Because we are considering everything on left stationarity, so this will be the case. Okay, so then also converse is true. What do I mean by that? I'll just state that. This means that if you start with any measure space, sigma finite measure space, and a measurable action which is quasi-invariant, you can always define these quantities by two, and then you'll have a random field yg which will satisfy one of these two. That's in that sense converse, which means you can start with any quasi-invariant action, and you can get a symmetrical first ever random field from there. Yes. So this phi g is this map. So you have a group action, this map which sends x to g dot x. Phi g already there. See, I'm saying there exists. So you have a space and there exists an action. So there exists a space gamma with a measure sigma finite measure mu on it, and there exists a group action such that this holds. And the way you should think about it is always going back to definition of stationarity. Stationarity means some kind of invariance holds. Just try to read it off at the level of representations, and then you will won't get invariance, you'll get quasi-invariance there. Okay. Sorry. Okay, a converse, okay, I should perhaps write it down then. It's better to write it down, no, it's always good to write it down. Okay, actually that's going to be very important for this talk also, so I think it's a good idea to write it down. Yeah. Thank you for the question. So given, so this is the converse statement. So given any measure space, gamma, and any quasi-invariant action of G on gamma, and any, I should have stated that also, in L alpha, by the way, this phi is in L alpha, right? All the FGs are in L alpha, an L alpha map, a phi, there exists a stationary, left stationary that is, symmetric alpha stable random field, YG, which has a representation of the form 2. Sorry? Yes, yes, definitely. It's very important. No. This has to follow stable law. This FE doesn't have to follow any law, even any function. So this guy's, so these are the random variables. They should follow stable law. Sorry, or is it, let's go back, yeah. So, of course, said that if you have alpha stable random field, not necessarily stationary, then you can always get a bunch of alpha functions indexed by G, so all the finite linear combinations this one can be read off from these functions. These are the same CIs. Same CI. Sorry? So it means that this is a symmetric alpha stable. This norm is this one, this guy here. So assuming that all of these G's are in L alpha, all of them in L alpha, so this whole thing will be in L alpha, though this will be finite. Okay, is that clear? Okay, thanks. Okay, so now I'm saying that if you have a stationary case, your FG would have a very specific form, which is one function transferred by this action, non-singular or quasi-invariant action, and then with this Radon-Nikodym derivative co-cycle. And the converse statement says that whenever you start with any space, any action, and any function which is in L alpha, you can always find such a collection of random variables. This is what this is. Okay, it's clear now, right? Okay. So any other question? Yeah, sure. Yes, yes. So in the Gaussian case, I expected that question. So, Gaussian case, up to whatever I have said is true, but then I never said anything about uniqueness here. So the, whatever uniqueness I would need, that I'll hide under the carpet, but we will need for our proofs, that will all go away. So that will be the problem. Okay. However, you know, in Gaussian case, whatever problem we are trying to solve has a different approach to solving. So Gaussian is anyway well studied, so it's not going to be important there. Yes. Yes, any action. That's very important. That's why I wrote down the statement. So in other words, this means that you can just start with your favorite action, whatever that is, and then to see what is the corresponding S alpha as random field and try to study its property. And that's what we have done. We have actually looked at actions which arise in hyperbolic geometry. So that's what we have done. Yeah. Okay, any other question? Yes, please.
Yeah,
sure,
so
sure. Yes, because the moment you specify all the finite linear combinations, you're basically specifying the joint distribution. So this uniquely specifies the joint distribution, which is a... Yes, yeah, exactly. So essentially, all the joint distribution, I didn't say it, but that's a jointly stable distribution. Yes. Okay, so now... So one of the things that has been a interest of research, my PhD advisor and many other people, is that you take Y alpha, G, which is a symmetrical, stationary symmetrical first table random field. Now look at its the corresponding group action. So this is a quasi-invariant group action. Now this is a purely probabilistic object, and this is an ergodic theoretic object. Now essentially the idea is try to correspond the probabilistic properties of these guys, the probabilistic properties with ergodic theoretic properties here. Try to have results which will correspond this with that. And one of them I'm going to state now. There are others also. I'm just going to take one of them, one of the properties. So for that, I'll need a little bit more. This is where first time I'll actually use that G is finitely generated. So far, whatever I have said, it's true for any countable group. In fact, you can also extend it to locally compact groups also. But I'm not going to do that. Okay, so now what is the role of finitely generated group now? Now suppose G is finitely generated. Fix a symmetric generating set S and look at the Ward metric with respect to that. See, in other words, you can also think of this as a graph distance is a corresponding Kelly graph. Okay, so now you look at a sequence of G suitably chosen so that Bn increases to G, so they exhaust G. Now, to start, in my talk, I'll just concentrate on this guy, so maybe I'll write it here. Example, and this is what is going to be my Bn for now. In the Ward metric, the n ball. So look at all elements in G, which are within n distance from E. Okay? Later on, what Mahan will do, he will actually change this definition and use some other balls, because there he will assume more structure on this space gamma. At this point, gamma is a measure space that supports invariant action. Later on, he will have structure on gamma, then that would be reflected in this Bn as well. So let's just take that Bn to be exactly that ball. And then what we can do, we can define a sequence of random variables, Mn, as the of the G runs over Bn. So this is a sequence of random variables because I'm taking the maximum bunch of random variables. So this is a sequence of random variables. And the question that we're interested in is the following. So I'll write it there. This is a sequence of maxima. And of course, since this Bn grows to G, you would expect that sequence Mn will also grow to infinity. And then the question is, at what rate? The question, how fast does the sequence of random variables Mn grow as n goes to infinity? Now, first ask yourself, okay, what if these YGs were just identically distributed and independent? By the way, because of stationarity, we know that all the YGs are the same distribution, so they are identically distributed. What if they are further independent? What happens then? So in the IID case, just to have a comparison, in the IID case, so if then one can show that actually grow like bn power 1 over alpha. In the sense that when you divide by this, this will converge in distribution. Some random variable, which I'm not going to specify much, it's a non-zero random variable. Importantly, this is a random variable, but it's non-zero. So the exact rate of growth would be given by bn power 1 over alpha. This can, you can do it from standard extreme value theory. It basically, what you have to see that the tail of these xgs, of these ygs, they have power law tail. From there, this, you can read this off. It's very easy. Okay. Now question is, suppose you have dependence among the ygs. Under what condition can you say that same behavior, at least qualitatively, will hold? In the sense that the rate of growth will remain the same as the IID case. So here is the question. I can make the question slightly different. So under what condition now, I'll give you a bit of gap. The growth Mn will be IID-like. Now, when I say IID-like, I mean that qualitatively, in the sense that, you know, this random variable may change. There might be some other constants coming in and so on. As long as Mn divided by Bn power 1 over alpha converges to a non-zero random variable, I'd be happy. So that's what I mean by IID-like. Okay? Now, what kind of condition do I want? As I already stated that our goal is to somehow connect a probabilistic question coming from stationary S alpha's random field to an ergodic theoretic question on AG, which is a quasi-invariant action, which is a completely ergodic theoretic object. So of course, the question would be, how can you give a condition on this guy so that, you know, the behavior of the maxima is same as IID? So if it's zero, that means maxima is growing at a slower rate. That's why after dividing, go to zero. That we'll see such things. Okay? So the thing is, okay, so now since you have asked the question, I think now it's a good time to say this also, give this heuristic. So if you have, it means that, say, whatever value one of the YGs take has nothing to do with whatever other values they take, right? They're all independent. So therefore, you would expect that the rate of growth would be higher than there is strong dependence between YGs. If you have very strong dependence between YGs, then if one YG takes some value, some other YG would take something very close to that value, and therefore the maxima will grow slower. Okay? So in some sense, if this goes to zero, then you would expect that the YGs have more dependence. What I'm asking is, can I characterize that dependence through the group action phi G? That's the question I'm asking. The precise question is, under what condition on this group action phi G will the behavior of Mn, or the growth rate of Mn, would be like IID case? So that's the question that I am trying to answer. Okay, so now I'm going to give a little bit of history here. So what has been done so far? So now G equal to Z case was solved by my PhD advisor in 2004. I'll give the solution, but I'm just going to give the history first. And Z to ZD, still there was something left, and that was part of my thesis. Okay, so then what is the solution? So I need to give you some more definition. Now that I have already given you the heuristic, definition also, I'll give you the heuristic there also, but let me give the definition. Now this is an ergodic theoretic definition. So a measurable subset of gamma, so remember that you always have a group action. So you have a space gamma on which this group G is acting in a quasi-invariant way. And this action is given by these functions, phi g, which are maps from gamma to gamma. So suppose you take a subset of gamma, measurable subset of gamma. It's called a wandering set If you look at the translates of this W by the action, that collection is a pairwise disjoint collection. Let's take an example. It's always good to take an example. That will come in the definition, next definition. A priori, the W can be a null set, either null set or mu null set, whatever, it doesn't matter. So here is an example. Suppose you act Z on R by translation. So phi G of X is nothing but G plus X. Shifting integer. So you can very easily check W of say 0, 1 is a wandering set. So that's because all the translates of 0, 1 are pairwise disjoint. Okay, so basically wandering sets are those which by the action go away from itself. Now the next definition will not allow such sets to exist. So definition, phi g. So this is, whenever I write this, it means it's a non-singular action or a quasi-invariant action, is called conservative. Sometimes it's also called purely conservative, but I'll just write conservative. If it does not admit any non-trivial wandering set. Now obviously any trivial set, any mu null set would be a wandering set. So, and by the way, when I say pairwise disjoint, I always mean modulo mu. Okay, because we are working on a measure space. Everything is modulo mu null set. So if action which is conservative, it does not allow one set, which means it does not allow a set which wanders around too much. Which means if wherever you start from, you have a tendency to come back to itself. Okay? So in an analogy would be in Markov chains, these are like recurrent states which come back to itself. Okay? Something like that. So what would be an example? So here is an example. Well, I'll give a bunch of examples. So if the action, so if mu is, okay, if mu is a finite measure and action is measure preserving or invariant, then it is conservative. So in other words, the measure preserving actions on a finite measure space are always going to have no wandering set of positive measure, obviously, because you take all the translates and they'll all have the same measure because of measure preservingness, and that will contradict the finite of the measure. Okay, so now how is it connected to the question that I wrote down there? So, yes, you can. Yeah, of course. Helmholtz or Poincaré, all of them, yeah. Okay, so it's connected this way. So here is the theorem. So d equal to 1 case was my advisor's work, and then deeper than 1 was done by in my thesis, as I said. Okay, so g is zd. Ba is as usual. So you can just take a standard set of generators on zd. So you can take then you take Bn to be the standard thing. This, in this case, it's 0. At the ball of radius n, then here is the theorem, which says that So this will converge in distribution to zero if the action is conservative. It will converge to non-zero if not, if the action is not conservative. And again, the heuristic here is the following. If you have a conservative action phi g, it will come back again and again in gamma, and that will induce more dependence in yg. And because of the more stronger dependence, the maximum will grow in a slower rate, as I've already said. And therefore, when you divide by this number, you'll get a zero. On the other hand, if that is not the case, you'll get something non-zero. By the way, these z alphas that I'll write in different cases may be different in the sense that it will be same random variable multiplied by a different constant. But I'm going to specify what the random variable is. For me, it's important that this is just non-zero. But for those who know, this is pressure type extreme value random variable. Okay. Yes. This is, yeah. Yeah. In fact, it's a continuous random variable. So the theorem is, you take the group to be ZD. The action can be any quasi-invariant action. Anything, anything. No, but, no. You have a stable, symmetric alpha stable random field, YG, that gives you an action, right? That action, you look at, if it is conservative, you will have this behavior. If it is conservative, you'll have this behavior, okay? So essentially, if you look at the asymptotic of this guy, this is a completely probabilistic question on YGs, which we are answering in terms of ergodic theoretic properties of phi Gs. So it's a correspondence between these two words. Okay. So therefore, this says, as long as the group is ZD, IID-like behavior is preserved if and only if this action is not conservative. Of course, the question is what happens to other groups, and if you look at the proof, which I'm not going to give because of time, but if you look at the proof, it uses the fact that the boundary of a ball is much smaller than Bn, so it uses amenability everywhere. So we thought that perhaps looking at some other group as a good test case would be nice. So we looked at the free group. Okay. So the next thing is, look at free groups. Okay, before that, okay, I should say this. So generally, for any finitely generated group, this much we could prove. This much could be proved. So this was a work with the then master student Shourav Sarkar, who's now finishing his PhD in Berkeley. The paper came out last year. So what we could prove is that for any finitely generated group, one of the side is true in the sense that phi g is not conservative implies Mn is IID-like. Yeah, I'm just going to be. So it just means that this limit exists. However, we could not prove in general completely. We could only prove it subsequently. In general, we could only prove it subsequently. And what that means is that if you give me any subsequence of the sequence, Mn over Bn over alpha, I can always find a further subsequence which will converge to a non-zero random variable. However, the choice of the non-zero random variable may depend on the subsequence. That's the problem. Actually, the non-zero random variables are all constant times one random. The constant depends on the choice of the subsequence. That's the problem. And that we could prove any in general for any group. However, then of course, question is what happens to the other case? So there, in some sense, there are open questions in the conservative case, but the non-conservative case, when the action is not conservative, a wandering set, you have a qualitatively an IID-like behavior. So the interesting part is when the action is actually conservative. So from now on, you restrict to conservative actions, actions which do not allow any wandering set. So from now on, and this will be true also in Mahan's talk, the action and the underlying action will be a conservative action. Now here's what we could do, and this is where the hyperbolic geometry or negative curvature came into the picture. Is that at, yeah, sure. I think so. I haven't done the calculation, but yes, I'm sure. You have to just, yeah, if you take the Folmer sequence. Yes. If it's binomial growth, definitely you can just frame the same beam. And if it's not, then yeah, you have to just take the Folmer sequence. Yes. Yeah. I'm quite sure, because the proof, the way it goes, I'm quite sure it is. We haven't really written it up, but yeah. Okay. So the question is, what would be an interesting conservative action? And it so happened that Mahan was visiting ISI Kolkata at that time. I was in Kolkata at that time. And I asked him, okay, suppose you take the group to be free group, what do you think would be a natural conservative action of the free group? He immediately said, look at the action on the boundary. And then I had to go back, Google and study, and ask him a lot of questions, and also Kingshuk, who's my friend also, I asked him a lot of questions. Finally, I got to know that a natural action which is conservative for free groups is the action of the free group on the boundary. And fortunately, Vadim has already defined this boundary for me. I'll be quick. So suppose FD is generated by, okay, maybe I'll just do it for F2. Same thing can be done on any FD. It's slightly easier to write it. So these symbols A, B, A inverse, and B inverse is a standard set of generators. Sorry. So this is my S. And then what I look at is I look at the boundary of F2. So F2 is nothing but set of all. So this is all finite reduced words. Now the boundary would be all infinite length reduced words. So this would be my gamma. So this is going to be my gamma. And what would be the measure? So the measure would be the measure that Vadim talked about today, namely the exit measure. So mu would be the exit measure of the simple random walk on F2. So the simple random walk starts at E, and it goes to one of the fibers in the Kelly graph, A, B, inverse of B inverse, with probability 1/4, and it just goes on. So this is the exit measure. Of course, this is a probability measure. So this is a probability measure. Now what we checked is that this measure, So first write down the action. Now I have to give you an action, a group action. So since the probability measure, I can take this function FE that I had in the Strozinski representation to be the one function. So identically equal to one on gamma. So since mu is a probability measure, it is clear that FE belongs to L alpha. And then look at the action of on its boundary. Now what is the action? So anything here is just an infinite walk. You just put this finite word at the left of it and then concatenate. So the action is left concatenation. Followed by reduction. Now what is shown is that this action is quasi-invariant. It's not invariant. Okay. this is what we are looking for. A conservative action, which is quasi. And interesting, in this case, if you look at that Fe, which is the identically one, look at that particular action, look at the corresponding symmetric alpha stable random field, corresponding symmetric alpha stable random field. So I told you that for any action, any L alpha function, there is a symmetric alpha stationary symmetric alpha stable random field. Look at that corresponding thing. And for that one can check that Mn, the behavior of Mn is IID like, in the sense that when you divide this by Bn power 1 over alpha, this converges to some non-zero random variable Z alpha in distribution. So what is different between, what is different from ZD? So in ZD, you would never find a conservative action for which the maximum is IID-like. Not even subsequentially, because you'll have zero in the limit. However, here, you could find an example, Mn actually not even subsequentially, it's true for the whole sequence. This whole sequence Mn grows like the IID case. So we are able to construct a conservative action through this boundary action, for which this a new phenomena is observed. So then, of course, the next question that will motivate Mahan's talk is that exactly what property of the action are we using? We'll try to abstract out that part, that is our work. So one thing that we can definitely do, now we'll only consider on the conservative action, and since many of these actions will be boundary actions, and in many cases the boundary will have a natural probability measure on it, on which you have a quasi-invariant conservative action, well, from now on, we'll also assume that mu is a finite measure, unless mentioned otherwise by Mahan. So mu would be a finite measure. We'll take a finite measure, and then we'll work on that. So in fact, he will just, without loss of generality, he'll just assume this is 1, so that it's a probability measure, and he'll work on that. So essentially, of course, we'll look at our favorite examples of group actions coming from hyperbolic dynamics, and we'll look at what happens to the corresponding maxima sequence. When does it behave like an IID maxima? When is the behavior IID like? This is the broad question. So now, over to Mahan now, or we'll have a break.
Yeah, we can take a few questions now, then we'll break, and then Mahan will continue after 15, 20 minutes, so maybe we can have a few quick questions. Yes, sure.
Not always. So what he's asking is, what happens to the conservative case in ZD? Do you know the exact rate? Not always. So in examples we know, and under some more conditions, we can compute the rank of the action, and then in those cases I know. See, it would be some n power p over alpha, where, okay, so in the ZD case, of course, Pn grows like n power d. So Bn power 1 over alpha is n power d over alpha. So in some cases, we are lucky where we could compute the rank of the action, and then where we could do n power p over alpha, p is the rank. But in general, there are examples where the rate can be anything. It can be logarithmic, it can be power, it can be a mix of both, lots of examples of it. Yeah. That's a good question, yeah. Yes.
Yeah, you have mentioned a good theory approach, but you haven't used the word ergodicity. So, are you imposing any conditions concerning ergodicity
of your action?
No, not here. No. So all we need is the hot decomposition. So you can decompose the action into conservative part, purely conservative part, and purely dissipative part.
Yes.
That's all that we use.
Okay, but still. If we want to argue in terms of random fields, does absence or presence of ergodicity would mean anything?
It can help. It can help in some things. For example, if the action is dissipative, then it has a very specific structure. It's called mixed moving average. There's a specific structure. But then under ergodicity, it will become what is called moving average. So you can make some extra input there, but not for this question. For this question, ergodicity somehow doesn't play any role. What plays a role is the Hopf decomposition.
What kind of worries me is the fact that dissipative actions, actually, they have very simple structure.
Right. You can use Kringle's theorem, yes.
Orbits, so...
Exactly.
How can it be reflected in your results?
Yeah, so basically, any dissipative action would essentially a shift action. You can, there's a result of Kringle, which will say that it's a shift action, and then you can make another space where it don't change anything. It's essentially a shift action.
Yeah.
And then invoking that, you can show that any such random field will actually look like what is called a mixed moving average. It's known in probability called mixed moving average. It'll come from the, I can show you what how it looks like. Yeah, so that's how it'll help in that sense. And under ergodicity, it'll become a moving average, exact pure moving average. Yes. Yeah, I draw meaning I can show you the distribution function. So it's a, obviously it's supported on the positive side, and the distribution function will look like. This is how it will. Yeah, and of course there'll be a constant all the time. The constant will be all different in different places. In particular, the constant will depend on the choice of subsequence that I take in this theorem. So the tail behavior is like power law. It's a power law, yeah. It's expected, because, yeah. You're taking power law and then taking the maximum. You expect that the limit will have power law. A tail estimate is going to, whenever it will be IID-like, it's interestingly, so far what we have seen, whenever it's IID-like, the tail behavior is the same. The limit is the same. Whenever it's IID-like, it may depend when it's zero. So for example, he asked a question, right? When it's zero, how does it look like? There are examples where the maxima divided by this will actually go to a random variable which is looking different. In this case, whatever we've seen, all the things are the same, up to a constant same random variable.
Yeah. There are no more questions. Let us break for 15 minutes, and then we'll continue. Let's thank Patterson.